Can you, none?
This song I wrote for a TV show back 15 or 20 years ago. I was married to a wonderful woman, Pat Brigadine, and ACTV, Austin Community TV. Some of you might remember from way back in those days. We had a TV show called Brigadine and Friends, and it was Brigadine and Friends in Paradise was what this was from. So this song is called Paradise. It's a slightly different take on heaven, on paradise than that one. This is a sing-along. We have a two-measure sing-along between each verse, so if when we get there, if you'll sing with us, you'll learn it. I think you'll find that's pretty easy. Just practice it.
Nice.
Really good. Okay, so here we go. Itself to harmony. So would you please sing along with that when we get to that in the next two verses?
If you make a mistake and you're feeling sad, remember that deep down nobody's bad. Give it a little thought and you'll observe that paradise is what we all deserve.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
If you get scared of the by and by, remember that your soul can never die. Give it a little thought, you'll comprehend that paradise is the living in. Paradise, paradise is a thing nice in paradise.
We're the old hats. This is John Mankowski, the fourth. This is Morgan.
And old hats have a show coming up with some of our other open mic regulars at the Library Live. It's an event coming up next week, but I'm going to let Eric tell you about it when it's his turn. Yeah. He's got the flyers. Okay, next is one of our veteran writers for our feature. Her name is Chris Schultz.
Hi, my name is Chris, and I was actually, I'm a native Austinite. I was born in Austin. The first poem that I'm going to read is called Guardians of Liberty. Until the last cadence is finally called, I am a soldier undaunted, that is all. Until every last brother and sister come home, with every beat of my heart, their soul lives on. Standing ready at the call at danger's gate, rest assured for that moment, we all wait. Sleep sound, my country, and without fear. For our sacrifice, please never shed one tear. For this path we march, our gift to you, the danger and cost we already knew. With vigilance we assure the path ahead is clear. For freedom we stand united, far and near. Countless brothers and sisters stand just like me, protecting freedom with blood as guardians of liberty. Never read publicly before, so bear with me. Thank you. The next poem that I've chosen to read is called The Gathering, and this is actually a location in South Austin where I grew up. The wind carries a scent on its breeze, and the trees sing memories of your voice to me. The setting sun bathes me in past embrace, and I am taken back to evenings spent neath the oak trees, watching fireflies light the shadows of dusk, when laughter filled the air, so sweet its memory dispels the grief of your absence. I am transported to a time when your presence was true, when speargrass wars raged between the youth and troubles were chased away by the family gathered neath the oak trees. The sweet memory of yesterday's love, always available when tomorrow's troubles are mountains in view. A simple delight plucked from the shadows by the fireflies of memory.
Well, this is the first time I've been to Malvern Books. I was on my way to another venue. I just stopped in here to use the bathroom, and I found out there was an open mic here. So, hey! did anybody else here go to the Women's March today? Boy, I almost didn't make it because I was had a hard time figuring out what to wear. But I had a really unique sign. You know, my sign was different than a lot of other people's. Mine said, hot, horny, and ready for action. I don't think we women should be afraid to play the sex card. I know that I'd sleep with the entire Texas legislature if I thought they would fund Planned Parenthood. But notice I didn't say Texas Senate. A girl's got to have standards. So I feel kind of like an outsider with women because I identify as a woman, but I don't identify with women. Because the thing is, women are too neat. I had these roommates, and they'd always be saying, oh, fancy, put your beer cans in the garbage can. Oh, fancy, flush the toilet when you're done. Oh, fancy, don't leave your crafts on the kitchen table. Well, I've got to admit, taxidermy is kind of a messy hobby. Maybe I shouldn't have started out with the larger animals, but it's so much easier to scoop the stuff out of their craniums, you know? Let's see, what else have I got here? Getting ready to go. I want you guys, don't judge me by the buttons I have here, okay? Because, like, look at this one. Black Lives Matter. Oh, I guess. This one right here, what does it say? Atheists vote too. Well, big deal. Actually, the reason I have these buttons on is because they hide the stains on the shirt. Thank you.
Writer from the Veteran Writing Classes, Ray Miller. Hello, U.S. Navy. I'll just get right into it because this one's a little long. I too don't read much in public. But the beautiful day. It appeared that the day would lack the ingredients for sorrow, misfortune, and tragic events. Just sunshine and laughter on a soft summer breeze with nary a tear as far as the eye can see. There were burgers and bratwurst and steaks on a grill, softball games, contests, and everyone's fill. A general din occurred from this noise, expressing the joy of the parents, the girls, and the boys. With all of this fun and the festivities, why should anyone notice a rustling of leaves? Why would anyone pick this day to care about nature or hunger or a desperate bear? But this wonderful park was once a large woods. Bears used to hunt where those trees once stood. That's until man and his kind made gone all the trees, gone berries, gone grubs, gone nectar of bees. Well, this one bear remembers, and he's now come home. He's eternally hungry. He endlessly roams. Fear these humans once drove him away, but now out of options, these humans became prey. When leaf falls from tree, as a native might tell it, deer hear it, eagles see it, and the mighty bear smell it. Today, the scent of a human will test this bear's skill, born on a breeze and carried over a hill. The scent led the bear right up to the park, moving through areas that the shadows made dark. Its ability for stealth was both impressive and keen, slipping right past the ball game without being seen. The bear then observed Mother Nature's request to seek out the weakest, the least able to resist. A little boy by himself, his parents away, unaware of the end of the beautiful day. But the breeze carried also the scent of the bear, available to any nose that might pull at the air. A black lab named Coffee turned fast at the bear scent. Then he too saw the boy, and he knew what that meant. Coffee barked out a warning while fast on his way. The human word bear is what he wanted to say. He darted past tables, dodged a lady in a chair, then ran straight for the boy to fend off the bear. Now, those who know Coffee, they know a usual dog. He plays all day long, and then he sleeps like a log. He'll find you his ball all day if you wish, and he'll guard anything that looks like a food dish. If given commands like lay down, sit, or stay, it's a comfort to know that he loves you anyway. And without hesitation, he'll quit his forage and fun to fend off this bear or whatever needs to be done. The lady stood up quickly and knocked over her chair. Interpreting for coffee, she screamed the word bear. Then others in the park became aware at long last, like the shock of a wave moving out from a blast. The bear charged right by a man stuck in mid-scream. Viewing scenes from his past, he was reliving a dream. Coffee looked to be flying over the short-bladed grass. Then the boy turned and saw them, both coming fast. But for Coffee and the child, there just wasn't enough time. You see, the bear started this race well over the line. Then the boy, doing the smartest thing he ever did, he tripped and he fell, and he tumbled and slid. That caused the bear's paw, as it swiped through the air, to graze the boy's head, getting nothing but hair. One hair for each year the boy's been alive, and one extra hair in hopes the boy will survive. The bear quickly regrouped and he turned and he reared, standing most at 9 feet from ankles to ears. The boy screamed, then scrambled to climb to his knees. But when he looks up, it's not the bear that he sees. Coffee had placed himself firmly right next to the child, and then he ordered the bear to return to the wild. For a brief hopeful second, it appeared the bear might, because Coffee, so poised, was a spectacular sight. But the bear was too hungry to meet Coffee's demand, so he put it into terms that we can all understand. He attacked from the north with the teeth in his mouth, and then with his claws he attacked from the south. Coffee absorbed every ounce of that vicious attack and tried to give to the bear a pound or two back. The man snapped out of his dream and made use of this time to grab the child's hand, and then he turned on a dime. While the man saves the child, Coffee distracts. Not a bad little impromptu plan of attack. But they needed more time to get him safely away. Such is the game that fate asked Coffee to play. Coffee had been wounded intercepting a blow that was meant for the man with the child in tow. Coffee's leg was torn, a bad gash on his nose. How he managed to press on, the Lord only knows. The bear then took advantage of Coffee's bad leg, and he went after the child with a zig and a zag. He lunged through the air and tripped up the man. The fall caused him to let go of the boy's hand. But somehow Coffee managed to get in between the bear and the man, once again in a dream. Refocused on the child, the bear took another chance, yet once again Coffee blocked that advance. Add up all the anger that can exist in an age, and that still wouldn't equal this hungry bear's rage. With the child defended, the bear veered his attack and crushed all of his weight down onto Coffee's back. But suddenly, loud noises came from out of the crowd. Getting closer and braver and shouting out loud, the bear saw the father carrying a bat made of wood with softball players following as fast as they could. It was the last of the seventh, and he was a runner on third. He started running when the crack of the bat was heard. The ball was traveling fast through the sky when his son and the bear and the dog caught his eye. He stepped over home plate and he picked up the bat, even as the noise from the hit was still echoing back. On another day, that ball might have been caught in midair, but in left center and right, there was nobody there. No chance existed to turn a sweet double play, because the infielders too were well on their way. They all ran past the umpire, who's apparently blind, with the opposing team's catcher in step right behind. Running toward the bear, they all made an attempt to explain to the animal that he had no consent. The pitcher took some spit off the tip of his tongue and let loose a fastball, the likes of Cy Young. The ball hit the bear right square in the eye. Welled up with tears, the threat multiplied. But when its vision cleared, it was amazed at the sight, for the whole Hall of Fame had surrounded him tight. Babe Ruth was swinging two bats in each hand. Bobby Cox was throwing handfuls of sand. Mickey Mantle had successfully aimed a line drive at a place on the bear that he needs to survive. They shouted and swung their bats and threw stuff. Half of the show was 80% bluff. The bear wanted to eat and he wanted revenge, but he could not take his eyes off the advancing men. With more jeering and jabbing, the men let it be known that not all of the cards in their bluff